Good morning. Welcome to the parish community of St. Francis of Assisi. In the presence of the resurrected Christ, let us praise God, singing hymn number 556, Glory and Praise to Our God. Number 556, please stand.
Morning. And on this glorious summer day, we continue our celebration in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. My friends, may the grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you. As we gather on this glorious day to give praise and thanks to our God, Scripture always challenges. The words of St. Paul speaking about the thorn in his side that eventually become a grace that allows him to find God is something that you and I hopefully share as well. The thorn is really maybe that thing or whatever that leads us to being separated and apart from God or feeling apart from God. We take a moment, we recognize our own inclination towards sin, and not responding to God's invitation of love. We ask for God's grace, and so we pray. Lord Jesus, you are the good shepherd who goes after the lost sheep. Lord, have mercy. Christ Jesus, you are the light that helps the blind to see. Christ, have mercy. Lord, you are the Word made flesh that helped the deaf to hear. Lord, have mercy. And may Almighty God have mercy on all of us, forgive all of our sins, and bring us all to everlasting life. Let us pray. Most high and loving God, your Son, Jesus Christ, was called to give light to a fallen world. We ask that you fill your faithful with holy joy, that we may seek to be guided by his presence and to dispel the sin that interferes in our relationship with you. We make this prayer through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
A A reading from the book of the prophet Ezekiel. As the Lord spoke to me, the Spirit entered into me and set me on my feet. And I heard the one who was speaking say to me, Son of man, I am sending you to the Israelites, rebels who have rebelled against me. They and their ancestors have revolted against me to this very day. Hard of face and obstinate of heart are they to whom I am sending you. But you shall say to them, Thus says the Lord God. And whether they heed or resist, for they are a rebellious house, they shall know that a prophet has been among them. The word of the Lord. Reading from the second letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, that I, Paul, might not become too elated because of the abundance of the revelations, a thorn in the flesh was given to me, an angel of Satan, to beat me, to keep me from being too elated. Three times I begged the Lord about this, that it might leave me, but he said to me, My grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfect in weakness. I will rather boast most gladly of my weaknesses in order that the power of Christ may dwell with me. Therefore, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and constraints. But for the sake of Christ, for when I am weak, then I am strong. The word of the Lord.
My friends, the Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. Jesus went out to his own part of the country, followed by his disciples. When the Sabbath came, he began to teach in the synagogue in a way that kept a large audience amazed. They said, "Where did he get all of this? What kind of wisdom is he endowed with? How is it such miraculous deeds are accomplished by his hands? Isn't this the carpenter, the son of Mary, a brother of James and Joseph and Judas and Simon? Aren't his sisters our neighbors here?" They found him too much for them. Jesus' response to all of this was, "No prophet is without honor except in his native place, among his own kindred, and in his own house. He could work no miracle there, apart from curing a few who were sick by laying his hands upon them. So much did their lack of faith distress him. He made the rounds of the neighboring villages instead and spent his time teaching." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Again, great to see everybody. Seems like it's been a long time. For anybody who knows me well, I have admitted that I have become a great fan or reader of obituaries. I always find them quite interesting. And especially here in Albany, there's usually someone that somehow I know, whether they are relatives of family members, of people that I went to school with or that I used to work with or former neighbors. Again, within our little community of Smallbony, there's always, again, somebody that you can probably know. But I guess what's more important is the fact that for a good obit, you often find that there is information that is revealed that conveys something about the individual that you really didn't know anything about. And it calls attention to certain attributes and gifts that the individual had that, you know, really was something that was not really known by the larger community. And of course, I love the New York Times Sunday because, again, their obit section is always filled usually with pretty famous people. But even those people that weren't famous but kind of lived in the shadow of famous people. And again, it calls attention to certain gifts and attributes of the individual that are really quite fascinating and interesting, to say the least. Regretfully, a couple weeks back, I lost a very good friend of mine. He was a parishioner from my parish at Sacred Heart in Tampa, Florida. probably about 75 years old. He was returning from a pilgrimage, the Camino in Spain, and he was with a group of parishioners and had a massive heart attack in the Miami airport. And to say that John was a wonderful man would be an understatement. And the obit in the Tampa Tribune really, of course, called attention to all of the wonderful attributes and gifts that identified with John. He was a father, he was a husband, but he was also, most importantly, he was a colonel in the U.S. Marines. And he was a distinguished colonel, and he served for 30 plus years in numerous places throughout the world. And he was beloved and honored by too many to mention. And yet, with all the accomplishments and the many honors that were attached to John's name, and his distinguished military career, John was also a good friend of Bill Wilson, the founder of AA. For many years, John himself struggled with his own addiction to alcoholism. But he later admitted that it was his cross of addiction to alcohol that allowed him eventually to find God. And with all of John's status and power and influence that he had, especially as a colonel in the military, it was his addiction to alcoholism that humbled him in such a way that, very much like St. Paul, that he discovered that God's grace was sufficient for him. And it was the power that he needed to overcome this weakness. And in his challenging years of recovery, John discovered himself personally the power of God's grace at work within him, so that he could find his own freedom to be the person that he believed God was calling him to be. And yet at the same time, John was able to lead other people who struggled with the same cross, that they might be able to find their own sobriety and freedom, and to know and experience the power of God's grace. Isn't it interesting? Oftentimes it is certain circumstances that arise within the lives of many people, unexpected difficulties or hardships or tragedies. But it is usually these experiences that give birth, if you will, to some of the great gifts and attributes that sometimes remain hidden in many of us, that most people are very much unaware of. And when you look at some of the great saints within the life of the church, you come to see that their early years are oftentimes far different from their ending years. And you look at somebody, of course, like our patron Francis of Assisi, who in his early years was known as the town playboy, whose mantra was wine, women, and song. But when he went off to battle to fight the neighboring enemy, he had a taste of war. He had a taste of death. He had a taste of being in the darkness of being a prisoner of war. And it was these experiences, I think, that led him to eventually finding God. And in finding God, he too found his own freedom that eventually led him to wanting to help other people to find God. And usually it was finding God in the least likely of people, namely the lepers, that they might be able to find God within themselves. And this is probably one of the great gifts that I think embodied St. Francis that helped him to be one of the greatest saints within the life of the church. And so for you and I on this glorious day, we take the words of St. Paul and maybe we look at them through a new lens. And maybe we ask ourselves to look at the thorn or the cross or the hardship that maybe hangs over our own head. And how do we allow this cross, whatever we may call it, to help us to find God? Does it lead us to finding God? Does it lead us to finding freedom? Does it lead us to hopefully finding God within ourselves, that we might lead other people to finding God? It is my hope and prayer, through the intercession of St. Paul and my good friend John, who just passed away, that we too will grow in wisdom and grace, and to recognize the weakness that maybe gets the very best of us will be the weakness that hopefully allows us to discover the power of God's grace that leads us to freedom. May God's peace and all that is good be with you. Together we stand, and in one voice and one heart, we profess our creed. I believe in God, Father Almighty, the creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell, and on the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there, he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. We now bring our own prayers and our needs and our hopes before the Lord. Our response will be, Lord, hear our prayer.
Excuse me. For God to raise up prophets in our time to challenge and console us, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the church to not be rebellious and be mindful of the movements of the Holy Spirit among us, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our nation, as it marks its foundation to reclaim the values of freedom with responsibility, civility, and justice for all peoples, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
hear our prayer. For people in need of food, housing, and medical care, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For people who are discouraged, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
hear our prayer. For hope in the face of sickness and death, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
hear our prayer. For faith and trust to mark the lives of those who grieve, and eternal life to be the hope of our dead in Christ, including Anne Marie Alacqua, Thomas and Jane Lemmy, Agostino and Jeanette Carriato, Patsy and Francis Serafino, Philip Restifo, Sheila F. Cahill, Daniel J. Flanagan, and Jean C. McGinn. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
hear our prayer. For the people and situations that we hold deep in our hearts and bring to this holy table, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
hear our prayer.
Good and gracious God, we ask that you continue to pour forth your Spirit upon all of us gathered here. Dispel the darkness of our hearts and of our world. Grant that we may always have a correct faith and a certain hope and a perfect charity as we seek to carry out your holy and true command. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
As we prepare the Lord's table and ourselves to offer the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, let us join in singing hymn number 412, Lord of All Hopefulness, number 412.
Lord of all joy, whose trust ever joy.
pray, my friends, that this, our sacrifice, will be acceptable to our good and loving God. Good and gracious God, on this holy day, we ask you to accept the special gifts that we bring to your table, the gifts of bread and wine and the gifts of our lives. May they always be acceptable and pleasing to you. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord. My friends, the Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just that we should always give you thanks and praise, Almighty and ever-loving God, for the countless ways that you seek to reveal yourself to the world and for your Son, Jesus Christ. For though the human race is divided by dissension and discord, you are always inviting us to change our hearts that they may come to know healing and reconciliation. By your Spirit, human hearts are moved so that enemies begin to speak to one another, adversaries join hands in friendship, and people seek the way of peace together. By the working of your Spirit, it comes about, O Lord, when hatred is overcome by love, when revenge gives way to forgiveness, and discord is changed to mutual respect. And so with all the angels and all the saints, we raise our voices to give you endless thanks. We join our voices with theirs, and together we acclaim. Lord, you are holy indeed, font of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending forth your Spirit upon them, that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, Jesus took bread into his hands. Giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat it, for this is my body, which is given up for you." In a similar way, when the supper had ended, he took the chalice. Once more, giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take all of you and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, chalice of the new and everlasting covenant. Be shared for you and for all people, so that sins may be forgiven. Do this in remembrance of me." The mystery of faith. As we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation. We give you thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and to minister to you. Humbly, we pray that partaking in the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world. Bring her to the fullness of charity together with Francis, our Pope, Edward, our Bishop, and all your holy people. Your Son has gained for you. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection. Welcome into the light of your face. Have mercy on all of us, we pray, that together with Mary, the Blessed Virgin Mother of God, with Joseph, her spouse, with the apostles, the martyrs, St. Francis of Assisi, and all the saints, on whose constant intercession we rely for help, may we praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. For it is through him, with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in union with the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Together now, in one voice and one heart, we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be free from sin, safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom and the power and the glory are yours. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, my peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, for you live and reign forever and ever. Amen. My friends, may the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with all of you. Let us now share with one another a sign of Christ's peace. Friends, behold. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold the one who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bring us all to everlasting life.
Let us become one voice and body of praise, singing hymn number 480, Shepherd Me, O God, number 480.
I'm doing shepherd, so nothing shall I want. I rest in the meadows of faithfulness and love. I walk by the quiet waters of peace. Shepherd me, O God, beyond my wants, beyond my fears, from death into life. And will you raise me and heal my weary soul? You lead me by pathways of righteousness and truth. Spirit shall sing the music of your name. Shepherd me, O God, beyond my wants, beyond my fears, from death into
Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we pray that you allow nothing to separate us from you. Having received this holy sacrament, body and blood of Christ, may we grow in wisdom and grace and lead others to the power of your love. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord. Amen. I don't think there's any announcements. That's good. My friends, the Lord be with you. Let us bow our heads and pray for God's blessing. May the blessings of Almighty God be upon all of us gathered here in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. My friends, our celebration has ended, but our lives continue. Let us go in peace to love God and to serve each other. Have a great rest of the day. Enjoy this beautiful weather. Have a wonderful week ahead. Stay safe, and thank you for coming.
Let us go forth singing hymn number 198. Holy God, we praise thy name, number 198.